In 2001, mysterious sinkholes were discovered in northern Lake Huron, and they've attracted researchers from around the world. There are otherworldly environments, and one way groundwater enters the lake, and today we take you there.
We're in the Thunder Bay National Marine Sanctuary in Alpena, Michigan. We're about ready to go out onto Lake Huron and retrieve some sensors in some offshore sinkholes.
Steve Ruberg is an observing systems researcher with NOAA's Great Lakes Environmental Research Laboratory. At least 10 sinkholes have been identified in Thunder Bay National Marine Sanctuary.
Lake Michigan, Lake Huron, Lake Erie sit on top of karst geology. What that means is that they're sitting on top of an ancient limestone layer, 400 million years old and older, residual from an ancient seabed, shallow seabed. Now, what we're looking at is a system that, as groundwater intrudes into that system, limestone begins to dissolve. That's how caves are formed. That's how these sinkholes were formed over time.
Some of the sinkholes are more than 300 feet across and up to 60 feet deep and act as passageways for groundwater, allowing it to seep into the lake. But how much? That's what these researchers are trying to find out.
Well, today we're going to go as much as 15 nautical miles offshore, and we're going to dive down into 350 feet of water. We're going to retrieve some sensors that we deployed last year. So we should, if everything went right, we should have about a year's worth of data.
The data collected today could help us understand if water flowing into the lake through sinkholes is an important factor in determining lake levels.
This is an area where there are a lot of sinkholes. We've counted about 10 of them that definitely have a defined depression in the bottom. We have Steve Constant, University of Michigan School of Natural Resources instrumentation expert. Kyle Beadle, University of Michigan Naval Architecture and Marine Engineer graduate, in addition to Captain Travis. Both of them will be operating the ROV and sensors as well as the retrieval mechanism. We're headed to our first station, which is called the Isolated Sinkhole. We'll be retrieving two sets of sensors from that station.
They'll use a remotely operated vehicle to pick up sensors from the lake bottom. It might sound straightforward, especially on a calm day, but finding these selfie stick-sized sensors in an area about the size of a football field in often hazy conditions can be a challenge.
I say head down and hopefully we'll stumble on it right away. Sinkhole is about 55 meters by about 35 meters.
Even with a camera, you can't always make out what's in front of you underwater. So the ROV also uses sonar to scan what's in front of it.
We should see a bright object, and there's a float with air in it. The air is less dense than the water around it, and so that you should get a strong signal off of that.
A blip on the screen could indicate they've found one of their instruments on the bottom.
So you're just kind of making your way around the edge of it?
The groundwater is colder and denser than lake water. And it contains more sulfate and less oxygen. It doesn't immediately mix with the lake water, and you can see where it is, even without instruments.
Yeah, you can see the groundwater. Yeah, so you can see the quagga mussels here, and then there are none down here. And so that's the influence of the groundwater. There's a little bit of haziness there from the difference between the density of the groundwater and the freshwater that's surrounding it.
One of the most fascinating aspects of the sinkholes is the fact that they are full of life. While quagga mussels, a persistent invasive species in the lower Great Lakes, cannot survive in the low oxygen groundwater in the sinkhole, cyanobacteria, the organisms which first oxygenated the planet, thrive in these conditions.
Go back down.
One by one, the team retrieves the sensors with the ROV, each carrying what they hope will be a year's worth of data, including temperature, flow, and how often the sinkhole turns over or washes out into the ambient lake water.
This is a current measuring sensor that uses tilt. So it has an accelerometer in it. So higher flow will tilt it over more and more and more. Lower flow, less. So the tilt correlates directly with the flow of the water.
This is from the sensor that we had deployed in the isolated sinkhole, the one we just retrieved. So that's a year's worth of data. Okay, we have it sighted. Yeah, there, you closed all the way.
You ready to come up?
Beautiful. So we just hooked on to the float that has a number of temperature strings pulled tight over a 5 meter distance. You're measuring temperature at multiple levels, so you can see how the groundwater is filling and refilling based on the currents that sweep it away sometimes.
After retrieving instruments from the first sinkhole, the team heads closer to shore to Middle Island Sinkhole.
We are at Middle Island Sinkhole, which has sort of the north end of it sheared off by glacial activity. There's sort of a bowl-shaped area there down within the sinkhole, and water fills that up and then spills over a ledge out into the wider area of the sinkhole, the wider area being the area that we call the arena. We'll deploy the sensors right on the wall between the alcove and the arena so we can measure that flow coming out of there.
The team will deploy a new set of sensors at the Middle Island Sinkhole to begin collecting data on groundwater flow in this location.
And the debris just upstream from them. Yeah, okay, you're gonna drop it right there. Wow, this is too easy. Oh, actually, you know what? Can you pick it back up?
The data from these instruments could improve the models used to predict how lake levels will rise and fall.
The Great Lakes are a large dynamic system, and the water levels are changing continually. They're on their way up now. The reason that is important to know that potentially small contribution from groundwater is that even an inch of water level change can make the difference in the way that freighter companies load their vessels, and that means money to them. So we want to be very accurate in how we develop these models.
At Great Lakes Now, we aim to cover the Great Lakes region and the people who live here, like you. Please follow us on social media, subscribe to our YouTube channel, and sign up for our newsletter at greatlakesnow.org. See you out on the lakes.